Morning, my name is Conley Greer. I am an assistant district attorney in Dawson County, Georgia. It's a pleasure to be here this morning. I'd like to start with a statement of facts that goes a little beyond that piece of transcript you're looking at right there. On page 700 and then also on page 646, she didn't just do nothing, she said no. Let's talk about how she got there. All right, she got there because she told Kathy Burt she was there, if you believe Ms. Burt, to film for the governor. You see, other folks had been there that day wanting to film too. This just wasn't a political rally. This was a small gathering, as the trial laid out, maybe 50 or 60 people, all that knew each other. They were in Dawson County. And they came in, they wanted to film. And they were turned away, said no, you can't do that here. She was treated differently because the owners, one of the owners, Kathy Burt, believed, hey, she's with the governor. The Burts, as you would learn if it's through the trial, were friends with Nathan B. Now, you can imagine what went through Ms. Burt's mind when she learned that she wasn't with the governor. And when Mr. Hutchins turned and looked at that camera and said, I don't know why you're filming. After he said what he called was a joke, I'd leave that for anybody to decide whether it was funny or not, what he said. I would argue it wasn't funny. That's why he wanted the tape and why he wanted the camera. All that came out. Well, they didn't do it like that. See, they didn't do it like that. They first sent someone named Mac Birch to tell her that they would like her to please stop filming, that the candidates were uncomfortable. That didn't work. They didn't send Clint Bearden. He's Judge Bearden now. He's one of our Superior Court judges. Go talk to her. See, Judge Bearden explained then to the jury that he had known the Birch since childhood, had worked on that farm in high school. He knew who owned them. He loved that family, and he was there on it. He set this whole thing up. They weren't paid a dime. They were just trying to serve their community.
Is there any evidence that she knew who they were?
None whatsoever.
That they were acting with authorization of the owner?
Judge, the only thing she knew when came out was she looked them up online. That's what she learned about Burt's farm.
Now, at the time that they came to her and said, you need to stop filming, is there any evidence that she knew that they were doing that on behalf of the private landowner?
Absolutely. Judge Bearden, or Clint Bearden, I'm going back and forth, so y'all please forgive that because I have to call him your honor back there, which is a pleasure. But he told her, I'm representing Kathy and Johnny Bird. They understand that she may have initially gave you permission, but they're revoking that permission. They would ask you to just sit down and enjoy the rest of the rally. Now, her response to that was, she shushed him. She shushed him. So he sat back. He even went so far as to warn her that if she didn't do as the owners, not him, the owners of this property requested, she would next be meeting a police officer. Yes, he was in a polo, but it also came out, y'all didn't hear all of that, that was one of their uniforms. They each have a different version of uniforms, and a defense expert, even who used to work with the sheriff's office, he's now the chief of the Correctional Institute there in Hall County, said, no, that's a standard working uniform.
So she was told, counsel, you're saying she was told that the owner had revoked her permission to be there before the police officer came over and said, Ms. Tisdale, would you please leave?
Oh, yes, Judge Miller, more than that. So he offered to take her to the owner so they could talk about it. See, this is the thing that's going on. You've got a lot of Republican officials there. You've got two owners that are friends with some of them. They're very nervous, all right? This is going on. You got...
During the course of the program and whatnot.
Yes, Judge. And he's now our senator. Senator Perdue's there. Virtually our entire state ticket's there. Plus, more importantly to them, their friends from the community are there. All right, this is a business. They've worked hard. Five generations in his family. They work hard for this place. So it's very important. Both, they see it as a patriotic duty, as you see when you look at the trial, that they do this. They're getting nothing from this. They got a lot of heartache out of this, but they got nothing for this. And they're also doing it for the friends of their community to hear these folks. So Clint Bearden tells her, though, you know, that's going to happen. She says, shh. Well, at the time, Richard Wood was speaking. Mark Butler's getting ready to speak. Tony Wooten goes over and talks to her. Two separate conversations occur. He looks to Johnny Burt and he mouths, Tony, get her out of there. That's testimony. Johnny Burt heard her say no from where he was sitting the first time. All right.
Counsel, can we talk about, irrespective of the meeting and who was there and those type things, the elements of the misdemeanor obstruction law?
Yes, Judge. It's quite simply, and our contention is that we proved that beyond a reasonable doubt. It's whether or not that she knowingly and willfully obstructed in his lawful discharge of his duty of police officer. Now, the cases that the appellant cites respectfully all deal with police officers that just got on the scene, hadn't seen no crime. But see, Tony Wooten had known what Clint Bearden and Mac Burgess had told her. He even gave her the same options. Please sit down or leave, or I'm going to have to take you to jail. But say he didn't even do that. Judge, say he just said, the owner says you want to leave. He wants you to leave. He's a police officer 24 hours, 7 days a week. He testified he was on duty. He's there to keep the peace. The property owner wanted her off his property. Didn't matter if it was a good reason, no reason, a stupid reason, or he just didn't like what she was wearing. This wasn't a public rally. It was open to the public, but it was on private property. But they had been polite and asked her to leave. So when she said no, irrespective, and we'll talk about the indictment here in a second, irrespective of that, she hindered it. Now, the indictment explains what role he was acting, but, Your Honors, when she said, no, I'm not leaving, that was a separate act of obstruction, as it's alleged. The way that it's alleged for it to be, for an arrest of judgment to be withstood, is that she could not admit it as alleged, which is alleged. It tracks our statute 610.24a to the T. All right, every essential element and the facts is alleged and still not be guilty. She can't do that.
So there's the, at the point where she said no, is it your position that at that point there, misdemeanor obstruction was proven, or was it anything that happened afterward when she was taken to the barn?
It was at that point when she said no and he had to say let's go. Then she was acquitted of the felony obstruction, but that's when the fighting started because she resisted that too. He had to physically remove her. When he had to physically start removing her, obstruction was complete. And that's captured on stage one, which that's what got us here. That's the statement of the facts of what happened. Everyone there knew he was a police officer, save one witness, Sclery Umberger. Even the defense witnesses all recognized. Every speaker that testified at this trial knew there was a police officer present. He made eye contact with her, told her he was a police officer. She knew a police officer was coming. Now, does he have to identify himself by name? Judges, y'all think about the different context our law enforcement officers get in. If they're trying to break up a fight at a bar, they're trying to stop a public disturbance, they usually don't say, hey, my name's George Smith or George Weaver or whatever. They just do it. Here, the badge is huge. He's got a gun on, a radio. You could spot him as a police officer a mile away. No, she meant she wasn't turning the camera off. And that's what got her arrested. The Harris case came out in 2012. And it's a kind of interesting case, but it stands for a lot of propositions. One of the things that the appellant argues in the brief is that the criminal trespass statute, what the appellant is asking y'all to do is to say just the same thing that the trial court. Martha Christian tried this case. Phenomenal judge, all right? That we have to prove, as a state, the underlying offense beyond a reasonable doubt. Harris said no, but Harris said more than that. The obstruction statute is broad on purpose because our police officers have an impossible job to do. And you can obstruct them in a number of ways, from being stubborn, from arguing with them, from just simply not doing a lawful command. Here he was acting lawfully in two different respects. If you look at how count two is alleged, both keeping the peace and as a representative, the final representative, the second representative of the property owner. Had the state been thinking, there was a criminal trespass that occurred when she told Clint Bearden, shh, no. She insisted that she had permission, and even though she had been informed that permission had been revoked, and she was on notice of that, Your Honors, because of the tax commissioner for the state of Georgia, or insurance commissioner, excuse me, had turned and looked at that camera. There's a big detail Clint Bearden talks about. They met with both Mr. Hudgens, who insisted on getting video, and then met with Senator Perdue, and they just wanted the filming stopped. So she's trespassing as it is. So her rights, her First Amendment rights, is adequately stated. She didn't have those there, at least not in that respect, but she knew that.
Well, she had been trespassing if it those officials said, we want that to stop. We'd like to have the tape. But the property owners had not revoked her authorization.
Oh, no. That's their property. And Mr. Burt would like to look y'all in the eye and said he'd throw even one of them off if they'd have made a scene, too. Because we talk about freedom, we talk about democracy, we talk about rights. And the folks in Hong Kong have got it right. They should want a better system. They should want this. But then when you work for something, it's been all you've had in your, that place was a dirt plot 100 years ago. And you work for something, you have rights too as a landowner. You ought not have to confront someone to get them off your property. That's why we have laws and why we have police officers. I cite the Lewis versus Ritz-Carlton case. You know, this guy's down there getting drunk in a lounge. And it's a criminal trespass we talk about a lot here. Well, to show you what standard of identification for something that's supposed to be so strict, that hotel manager just said, I'm the hotel manager. Calm down. Please leave. No. 2 hours later, this fella gets arrested by Atlanta PD in his motel room. Then you look at the Duncan case, you got an off-duty cop. He's a bouncer working at a nightclub. All right? Gets into a heck of a scuffle with a drunk patron. Go to trial, that drunk patron was charged with simple battery, public drunkenness, and obstruction. Well, they were acquitted on those two, but the jury convicted him of obstruction. This court said that's right, because he was a police officer. Police officer 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. So when we look at these elements and we talk about these things, the obstruction statute we prove. The arrest of judgment, there's no merit in that argument whatsoever if you look at our case law. There's a lot to talk about Stanbury now as we move to the jury charges. Well, the Jackson case back to 1980 set of premise. We look at the whole charge as a whole. And starting around transcripts 1501, when we do the jury charge, the charges she got was the charges she asked for. Judge Christian followed the pattern charge and even gave a charge that if an officer isn't acting lawfully, then he's acting illegally. You must find he was acting lawfully. Define what probable cause was. Defined beyond a reasonable doubt twice, and that we had to prove each element twice in those. She was thoroughly charged, fully. And the other difference in the case that they cite is that's dealing with where you have an accomplice testimony case. You have and that's the basis of your conviction, and you rely on that testimony, and then you ask for a single witness charge. Okay, that's obviously plain error. The fact that we're arguing, and that's when we look at a plain error analysis, it isn't subject for reasonable dispute. Well, I would argue what you're hearing there is a reasonable dispute about what charge, and they don't tell you what charge they should have given, but what charge should be given. Then it's not plain error. It's just not. After Stanbury came the Raines case, which is 304 Georgia 582, and the Supreme Court said an incomplete charge is not the same thing as a obviously errant charge. You don't have an obvious errant charge here. You have an adequate, fully charged. When you look at that charge as a whole, given the charges she wanted, all right, it didn't involve the murder, and it certainly didn't involve accomplice testimony, but it comported with the law fully. So there's our position is there's just no merit in these allegations.
Counsel, can you address briefly the issue of the indictment?
Well, in the indictment, Your Honor, what we alleged in count two was that at the time that he asked her to leave, he was also acting as an authorized representative of the property owner. Now, one of the things when you're doing an indictment is you want to lay out either you want to track the elements of the statute, and we also cited to the statute, and also the necessary facts. Here, this was a notice issue. We wanted to make sure there were no complaints about notice in this. We showed in what capacity he was acting. But when he's acting as a police officer, he is automatically acting in two regards. So the indictment says he was, as an authorized owner, requested her to leave the property. She can't admit that and not be guilty of the offense, because she did so in knowing that he was a police officer on duty in lawful discharge of his duties. That's why we included that in there. Notice is a huge deal. So for her to get an arrest of judgment or the appellant to even argue that, she has to be able to admit it's not absolutely void. It was adequate notice. Now, what appellant is asking y'all to do, and I'm going to end with this, is to read in a criminal trespass statute into obstruction statute and then argue a special demur into an arrest of judgment. We're asking that you not. It's been a pleasure to be here this morning. Again, we ask that you affirm the trial court and affirm this conviction. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anything further, counsel?
Just a small factual quibble, okay. A small legal one. Factual quibble. One interesting thing about this case is that Ralph Hutchins did swear in front of the jury that he never had a problem with the filming. He never requested that stop. That was in contradiction in this case. Honestly, based on the verdict, I don't know who the jury chose to believe, but those two accounts were contrary. Moving back to this issue about the instruction, in the state's brief, it argued that you didn't have to prove that the defendant knew that the officer was acting lawfully. But it sounded just there to me as though that the argument has now changed, that the argument is now that the instructions adequately informed the jury that they had to know whether Nydia Tisdale thought the officer was acting lawfully. Those are very different arguments. And I don't really see a way you could look at these instructions which say that it's irrelevant whether she committed the trespass statute to the obstruction statute and figure out a way the jury could intuit that they had to find that she had to know the officer was acting lawfully. When the judge explained what knowledge meant, all the judge said was that Nydia Tisdale had to know that this was a police officer. And the judge specifically said you do not consider the trespass elements when you consider the obstruction charge. On that basis, Your Honor, this is more than just not instructing the full mens rea. This is telling the jury that mens rea is met by something that is plainly inadequate under the law. And under Stanberry, under Henderson v. Haynes, that is enough for a new trial. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much.